pray with you.
Please rise if you are able and join me in the call of worship. The Lord is merciful and gracious.
Lord, in anger and in love.
Jesus calls us to be his disciples.
We take up the cross to follow him.
Let us worship God. Reconciled to God, trusting in God's grace and God's mercy, let us confess our sin before God and our neighbor. God, our Redeemer, we confess that we are people of ashes and dust. You call us to be a blessing to the world, but we only seek our own benefit. You call us to give our lives for others, but we only seek to save ourselves. Forgive us, God of grace. Set our minds on divine things, the good news of the gospel, and the promise of new life in you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now hear our silent, personal prayers of confession. Now the time has come at last. Today is the day of salvation. Believe good news. In Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Jesus, Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
eyes, that we may see the wonders of your word, and give us grace, that we may clearly understand and freely choose the way of your wisdom, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Today's first reading is from Romans chapter 8, verses 12 through 17, found on page 919 in your pew Bible. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all things are led by the Spirit of God. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness that our spirit, with our spirit, that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified in him.
So the next morning he gets up and he goes back to the mall and he looks around and he walks around and this guy notices him and decides today's the day I'm going to go talk to him. So he goes up and he says, I want to get to know you. I've seen you around and I want to know more about would you like to come to the movies with me and my family this afternoon? So he goes to the movies, and he goes to dinner with them, and he is so happy. He's like, I think this is what a family is like. So he goes, has such a good time. The dad looks at him one day and says, you've been coming to our house, and you've been eating with us, and you've been having such a good time. I think I would like you to be a permanent part of our family. We're going to adopt you. Well, you can just imagine how he felt to finally have a family that wanted him. So this is how it feels to be part of God's family. God opens his doors, and he opens his heart, and he welcomes everybody in that wants to come in and wants to be part of his family. So his family is not, it's very accepting. They're not judgmental. They don't care if you have shopping bags or popcorn bags. What God sees is what's in your heart. And he is glad to call you his adopted children. So we're going to go into children's church, and we're going to talk about that. And we're going to talk about all the things that Jesus taught us while he was here and how it feels to be part of the family. So everyone here is part of your God family. Your church family. Pretty cool, huh? Okay, let's stand together and say a prayer. Dear God, thank you for loving us and for considering us part of your family. We want to tell everybody how awesome it is to be a child of God. Amen.
Second reading comes from Mark chapter 3, beginning at verse 19c and going on through verse 35. You may not be aware of this kind of nomenclature, 19c. You may look in your Bible and say, I don't see a C anywhere. As most of you know, the scriptures, as they were originally written, didn't have chapter and verse divisions, and those were put in later, and some of them seem to interrupt the flow of the thought. And so here, I'm making a conscious decision. You'll see why if you read verse 19a and b, in other words, the first couple of phrases in verse 19. I don't want to read that part. I want to concentrate on what comes next, on the part that begins our reading. So let's listen for the words of the Lord. Then he, that is Jesus, went home. And the crowd came together again so that they could not even eat. And when his family heard it, they went out to restrain him, for people were saying, he has gone out of his mind. And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem said, he has Beelzebul, and by the ruler of the demons, he casts out demons. And he called them to him and spoke to them in parables. How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand. But his end has come. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his property without first tying up the strong man. Then indeed the house can be plundered. Truly I tell you, people will be forgiven for their sins and whatever. Flesh and blood. And people have heard that he has come, and so they gather from the region all around to hear him teach. And his family, his flesh and blood family, also come. They show up like we do, right? When my child has a piano recital, I'm right there, front row of the bus at the back, but I'm there. Very proud papa, listening to that piano recital your child plays sports. You know how important it is. Maybe his family just wanted to be alone with him again. You know, me and my four and no more. Mom, sisters, brothers, and that's it. We don't want all of these crowds who are constantly making their way in and getting in between us and Jesus. So they say, hey, Jesus, your mom and your brothers and your sisters, they're here to see you. And he says to them, who are my mother and my brothers? And then he looks around into the eyes of each and every one of those who had gathered to hear him teach that day. And he says to them, here are my mom and my brothers and sisters. Here. Maybe you felt that as a part of a church at some time or another since your baptism. When all the world would reject you, you felt welcome, embraced, encouraged, included, loved, and cared for. Even when flesh and blood family were far, far away, think often of the role that this church plays in the life of those military families who are stationed at Fort Campbell who make their way here. We become family. But on the other hand, how do you think that Mary and James and Jesus' sisters felt about all of that? Maybe they were a little bit hurt, a little bothered, a little annoyed, angered, troubled. We don't know how they felt about those words of Jesus. But Jesus is saying, my family is much larger than my four and no more. And if Jesus' family includes everybody who does the will of the Father, then it's even larger than this group of people gathered here this morning. Much, much larger. You see, Jesus' definition of family is radical. It's one that the church has tried over and over and over again throughout the centuries to embrace in baptism, and this Lenten season gives us a chance one more time to look at and examine what it means to be adopted by baptism into this family, to have received the grace of God, the adoption that we cannot earn but is given to us freely by faith. This one remarkable family of God where all of us are embraced and welcomed. Jesus talks often about this family. He gave his life to make us brothers and sisters. A lot of us are really happy to claim Jesus as our brother, but he didn't die just for that. He died so that we might be this family of true brothers and sisters in Christ, that we could give up that notion of my four and no more, to live into the embrace that Jesus has and to live into his vision of what family is all about. We have to give up some of our cherished ideas about flesh and blood relationships in order to receive the blessing of this much greater gift in a much bigger and wider family. Listen to what Jesus says about family. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whosoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever does not take up his cross and come and follow after me is not worthy of me. In another place he says, everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or children or fields for my name's sake will receive 100-fold and will inherit eternal life. On another time, his disciples say to him, Lord, first, let me go bury my father. And Jesus says to this disciple, let the dead bury their dead. See, Jesus sets a high value on a different kind of family. And it is this kind of family that we have to embrace in order to follow him. Yes, of course, our flesh and blood families can help us to do these things. There is no greater blessing than to have flesh and blood brothers and sisters who are also brothers and sisters in Christ, in faith. But Jesus is telling us that in the light of eternity, our individual families are part of a much larger family, the family of God. We are all one great human family throughout the Gospels, beginning when he was 12 years old in the temple. Jesus addresses God as Father. In Aramaic, Abba, we heard it in the epistle to the Romans, Daddy. A close and intimate and informal address to his Father. And Jesus talks this way with God to teach us how much God loves us, how much God cares for us, that the God whom we worship isn't some distant and powerful creator. He is, but he isn't just invisible and immutable and incomprehensible. God is also a Father who loves his children. He's never so far away from any one of us that he cannot hear our cry. And he comes always to our aid. There are people in our midst who are lonely. And out of that deep loneliness and desire and yearning to be part of a family, they often substitute other things. Things that harm and destroy life. Those people are looking so desperately for loving relationship and purpose and acceptance and belonging that one of the most faithful things that we can do as followers of Jesus Christ is to go and embrace one of these people and invite them in and welcome them and say, "You are my family." And that's what Jesus taught. And that's what untold millions of people have experienced in their baptism. Just a warning. See, I told you, I should never remember this. Just a warning in this Lenten season. Beware the false allure of a full lineup of family activities, sports and leisure and vacations and all the rest. Things that are designed to keep the family together. But they often fail to have the desired effect. How? How can we keep family together? By embracing the family that Jesus has offered us in faith, in love. Whatever we consider the ideal virtues of family life, we would do well to keep in our sights this great big family that Jesus tells us about, where ties are forged in our baptism and have an eternal significance. None of us is part of this family by flesh and blood. We have been adopted by God's grace. We were baptized into. And in a time when people are so desperate and so alone and so lonely, this family has a great mission and purpose to connect, to involve, to welcome, to embrace, to care for, and nurture all of the members of this family.
Thank you.
Let us begin prayer. Great eternal God, you are indeed exalted and holy and faithful, and you have given us life and family. With what will we ever repay? Take us back to the moment of our baptism. Take us back to that moment when we picked up your cross with grateful hearts, with humble spirits, offering our whole life for the sake of the gospel, so that we might receive your eternal life in its overflowing goodness. God, we pray for your church this morning. We pray by the gift of your saving grace that you would strengthen this family of faith. Make it stronger. Help us to welcome those who are alone, those who are deeply lonely, into this family of grace. You are indeed the God of all mercy, and so we pray for our world. As you called Abraham and Sarah to be a blessing to every nation, we pray that you would extend that covenant of peace throughout the whole world. We pray especially today for the lands of Syria. Father Abraham's clan came from a place they call home. We pray for our own community. We pray especially for those whose lives were upended last night by tornado, who have suffered flood. Make up this community an extended family, offering help and solace and hope and restoration. We pray that you would answer the cries of those who are calling out to you, those who are suffering. And help us to care for the poor and the weak and the young the way that we care for our own flesh and blood, that the lost may find their way home to you. We pray for our loved ones. We pray for Laura and Sean and for the delivery of a healthy baby. We rejoice with Tom and Charlotte at the marriage of their daughter Lisa. We pray with gratitude for good news from David Goder and Hank Livingston, Don Beck, even as we continue to pray for quick healing and recovery from surgery. Pray for Charlotte Jolly, for John Waddle, for Scott Sitter. For Diane and Sarah. For Shannon Conkle. For Ruby Jean. For Rick. Again, with gratitude for Steve Miner and Steve Wallace. For Larry. John Rocky. These are our family. Pray for your tender care. And now, as children of one big family, teach us again to pray the way that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and
the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Jesus has told us, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So let us offer our very lives to the Lord. Your offering will now be received. Tokens of our gratitude for your love and care for us, and use our very lives to liberate the oppressed, to break the bonds of injustice, to feed the hungry, to welcome the poor, to unite the whole human family. In the name of and for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Thank you. of you this morning, do not say that the preacher preached against family. Family, the love of family, dedication to family is a virtue. Jesus has come to transform our notions of family. Remind us that we are all brothers and sisters. As you go out this morning, there are those whom you will meet who have not experienced this family, a family of faith and grace and hope and love that we share here. Embrace them. Invite them. I would like nothing more than on Easter Sunday morning to baptize someone else into the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus. As we go, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of